like to introduce Larry Dapsis. He's a state entomologist. He's the foremost authority in Massachusetts on ticks, all different kinds of ticks. Over the years, you've noticed that when we were younger, there was the dog tick, the wood tick. Now there's about 17 different ticks that you're picking off of everybody in the family. Larry's here tonight. Tell us a little bit about the lifestyle of a tick and how to mitigate the circumstances, keep yourself safe, keep you, your family, your pets safe in your yard and anywhere else in the outdoors. So without further ado, Larry Dapsis.
Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks for the invitation. Actually, I don't work for the state. I actually work for Barnesville County. But I'm very happy to have this invitation by your association to come speak with you. All right, we'll go ahead and start. Hopefully the lights will catch up with things before we get into some detailed slides. So it is a beautiful summer evening, and I can't think of a better way to spend it than by having a very robust discussion of infectious diseases, okay? Certainly works for me. I'm with Cape Cod Cooperative Extension, and I've been there now almost exactly 6 years. Prior to joining the extension team, I spent 24 years in the cranberry industry with Ocean Spray. So when I came to Cooperative Extension, I didn't know anything about this. I really didn't know anything about ticks. I didn't know anything about Lyme disease, other than I heard about it, and it wasn't good. So I found myself on a very vertical learning curve, okay? And so to address that short term, I read everything I could get my paws on, okay? And I talked with a ton of people. I had to figure out kind of what the landscape really looked like, and it's very complicated. And then I had to figure out what's been done, what needs to be done, and how the heck am I going to help pull this off? And so after doing all that, I want to share with you my very first learning at Cooperative Extension. Everybody hates these things with a bloody passionate vengeance, okay? You say the word tick, it evokes an instant emotional response. People can almost accept mosquitoes to part of the, you know, food chain and aquatic ecosystem, but not so with ticks. And when I say everybody hates them, I mean everybody hates them. So when a gentle soul like the Dalai Lama turns his back on a form of life on this planet, that is a headline. Now, a number of you may not realize that His Holiness is actually quite a savvy guy, okay? And he actually tweeted this out one night about 3 years ago. I picked up on it, incorporated it into my deck, and I've been following him ever since. And last summer, he tweeted something out to declare he's modified his position on this matter just a little bit. Who knew His Holiness was such a hardcore New England Patriots fan? I absolutely love him. All right, let's kind of look at some data now, starting at like 40,000 feet and start drilling down. This is incidence rate of Lyme disease in the United States, 3-year average, okay? So Vermont, Maine, they've traditionally been number one and two. Sometimes it's Maine, sometimes it's Vermont. When this was calculated, we were number five. The previous 3-year average, we were number three. So if you look at those incidence rate numbers over on the far right, that's a pretty tight grouping. So it doesn't take more than a few cases one way or the other to kind of shift those rankings. But I think it's worth noting that all six New England states have these top six positions in the country. So if there was any question that we are living at ground zero with this problem, this should take that off the table right away. This is incidence rate in the state by county. So over here on the far left, Nantucket County and Dukes County, which is Martha's Vineyard, they have more incidence rate of Lyme disease than any place else in the visible universe. Now, Barnesville County, we were traditionally number three for as long as I've gone back and looked at the data. But Plymouth County, you guys, yeah, people that live here, just a few years ago, you passed Bartlesville County by a substantial margin, okay? And I know when I get the next set of data, Bristol County is going to pass us, and Bartlesville County is going to drop into fifth place. This is a race that we're losing over on Cape Cod. And this got the attention of people at Harvard School of Medicine. They were looking at trends in Lyme incidence rate data in the state, and they noticed that we're not increasing at all. Every other county in the state is doing this, okay? Except Bartlesville County. We are flat. We're not going down, but we're not going up. And when they started probing around and asking questions about why the Cape is so different, and they worked there for 6 years, I can tell you all kinds of reasons the Cape Cod is different than any place else in the state. But what they found out is that we're the only county in the state that has a very, very aggressive outreach program. We're the only county in the state that has a crazy bug guy like me doing things like this. So, and what I want you to do is pay attention to that number here, incidence rate on this axis, 300 to over 500. Let's look at your backyard in particular, okay? Marion, Rochester, Plimpton, Mattapoisett, Morrowell, Lakeville, and Middleboro, they're in the top seven positions in the county. These are hot, hot areas. Those incidence rates are on par with what we see on Martha's Vineyard in Nantucket. And so most of the towns within this county are hot, I mean, hot as a pistol. And this is the reason I've been called to do a number of presentations in Plymouth County, because a lot of the towns are starting to understand the reality of what you're dealing with. And so this got the attention of your Plymouth County commissioners as well. Last fall, I was asked to come to the county commissioners and your elected assembly delegates. Basically, you have one board of selectmen from each town to represent and guide county government. And they had heard about our program, and they asked me to come in, give an overview, kick the tires, pressure test it, and find out, you know, if this is worth pursuing. And what I did was I outlined an ironclad business case why it would be very cost effective to hire an entomologist for this county and to basically replicate the program we have on the Cape. The good news is your commission bought that proposal, okay? And that position has successfully made it through the budget process about a month ago, and they've already conducted interviews, so that by this fall, you're going to have an entomologist on the ground working on your behalf for problems like this, which is great, great news. All right, let's look at the different players that you might encounter here. This, as Chuck said, this is the American dog tick. Some people call this the wood tick. This is the tick I think a lot of us here remember growing up with. If we had deer ticks and Lyme disease where I grew up in Worcester, and the way I spent my youth, I would have had Lyme disease about 50 times, and we'd be having this discussion through a Ouija board, okay? I consider this actually now more of an annoyance than a public health threat, even though they can vector the pathogens that cause Rocky Mountain spotted fever and tularemia, both of which can be very serious, but they're quite rare in Massachusetts. Although last year at Brewster, we had a 10-year-old girl who was diagnosed with Rocky Mountain. She was medevaced to Boston and successfully treated. Here's our newest player to Massachusetts. This is the Lone Star tick, okay? And this thing is a very different beast. Okay? It's been moving north steadily for a number of years, okay? A number of ecologists think that this is associated or a function of climate change. We're seeing plants and animals where we never used to see them before. And up until about 3 years ago, the northernmost populations were on Cuttyhunk and Lashawn Islands, just off the west coast of the Vineyard. But 3 years ago,
Dad, we've got a low battery.
All right. ago, Cape Cod mosquito control help, we found the first established population on the Massachusetts mainland in West Barnstable at Sandy Neck Beach Park. That's a 6-mile-long peninsula, okay? And I took samples from one end of that place to the other, and I found Lone Star ticks everywhere, okay? They own that real estate now. And last fall, I found another established population in West Falmouth along the Shining Sea Bike Trail. And the reason I found out about this one is I was contacted by a doctor who had a patient, and they suspected that she had these tiny ticks attached to her, all right, tick larvae. But they couldn't see them, couldn't figure out what to do. And the doctor said she certainly couldn't use tweezers on them to remove them. I was wondering what the heck should she do. And what I told her is take the wonder product of the century, duct tape, put it over the welts, peel it off, send it to me, and I'll take a look. And I confirmed that they were indeed Lone Star tick larvae. And this woman actually had 182 of these things attached to her leg. So we are now seeing that this is starting to spread. And what I think has happened is these things have been introduced by migratory birds. These are perfect flyways for migratory birds. And I have surveillance information from wildlife cameras. And I think that our friends, the coyotes and the wild turkeys, are helping to ship these things around. So it's established a beachhead on Cape Cod. Is it here in Plymouth County? It well could be. It's just nobody's here doing surveillance. All right. This thing is a really different beast, and I wanted to kind of introduce you because if it's not here yet, it's coming. This is an aggressive biter, okay? When Lone Star ticks lay their eggs, they lay them in a cluster of 3,000 or 4,000. So late in the summer, August and September, these things hatch out into these really teeny tiny larvae. If you can see that scale there, they're 0.7 millimeters across. All right, they're basically steps. And so when they hatch out, you end up with this very high concentration of larval ticks in a very small area. So if you're strolling along and bump into one, generally you meet most of the family, okay? And within minutes, you can get overwhelmed with hundreds of bites from these things in a matter of minutes, all right? And the other stages of the tick are also very aggressive. The nymphs and the adults, they actually have really good vision, and they can run. They can run with spider-like speed. If they see you, they're going to chase you. They're going to hunt you down like a coyote on a little bunny, okay? And I've seen how fast they are. And while they don't vector the pathogen that causes Lyme disease, they've got their own diseases associated with it. So ehrlichiosis and tularemia, both of which can be quite serious. Sari is a type of rash disease with flu-like symptoms. It can be cured pretty easily with a few antibiotics. But the real game changer with this tick is that the bite of a Lone Star tick can trigger an allergy to red meat consumption. And this can range from hives all the way to anaphylactic shock. And I happened to meet a person last year on the Cape whose dad was bitten by a Lone Star tick on the Cape. Went to a family outing, had a burger. 2 hours later, he was in the hospital with anaphylactic shock. He could not breathe. And it's not just beef, but it's pork, lamb, and even beef byproducts like gelatin. And if you think about the processed foods that are available to us in the supermarket, beef-derived gelatin is used in a lot of products, including the marshmallows that we feed our kids, you know, with little gatherings. So it's a real game changer. I was reading some research a couple months ago where you can actually add gray squirrel to that list, believe it or not. That research was done down in Virginia. Okay, go figure, they'll eat anything down there. All right, this is still the front and center player that we're dealing with. This is the deer tick, but for reasons I'm gonna get into in a few minutes, the proper name for this tick is really the black-legged tick. All right, deer ticks are unlike Lone Star ticks. Deer ticks are blind. They're an ambush predator. They wait for dinner to come to them. So if you see this adult female tick on top of this piece of vegetation, And she's got her front leg stretched up like she's signaling a New England Patriots touchdown. All right? Well, she's not. What she's doing is sampling her environment. At the front of her front legs is an organ that can sense changes in the concentration of carbon dioxide. And so if you and maybe a pooch is strolling through an area and you're presumably breathing, you're changing the concentration of carbon dioxide around you. And she can detect that. She can also detect changes in temperature, like body heat, and she can detect vibration. So while she cannot see what's going on around her, she is perfectly aware of the stimuli, and she'll orient to them. And at the end of those legs, she has this beautiful little claw. And all you have to do is just gently brush up against that thing. It will attach and then start climbing upwards and looking for a place to do its business. All right, let's look at the hardware section. Okay, pretty fascinating stuff. All right, here's a deer tick over here. Here's a deer tick head under a microscope, all right? These things on either side of the head, these are called palates. That's what the tick uses to taste you and see if you're worthy of becoming a blue plate special, all right? If you are, it'll take these things called chelicerae. These are like little scalpel blades with hooks. And what that thing will do is it make an incision, hook in, and pull. So it's mechanically, it's kind of like doing the breaststroke. And with each further pull, it keeps driving this beak of the mouth part down further and further, deeper into your skin. If you look at that under a microscope, yeah, that's what we got, okay? Not only is it fairly long with respect to, you know, body size, but it's got those beautiful recurved barbs. So if you were ever trying to pull a tick out of you and you see your skin coming up and it's resisting, you feel like it's tearing out your flesh, well, it's because you are, okay? That thing, it wants to stay there for a while. From start to finish, a tick may feed on you for 4, maybe 5, maybe even 6 days. And the first thing a tick does when it attaches to you, it doesn't start sucking blood like a mosquito. Okay? First thing a tick does is it spits. They actually have no manners at all, no social graces. All right? And tick spit is fascinating. It contains hundreds of biologically active compounds. And one of the things in tick spit in the beginning is glue. That thing will actually cement itself in place. That's why it's so hard to remove them. You can't flip them away. And it'll also secrete things like anticoagulants to keep the blood from clotting, vasodilators that'll increase the flow of blood to the point of attachment, and things to deaden your nerves, because that tick wants to be undisturbed and very stealthy. And then it'll go through cycles of sucking blood, spitting, sucking blood, and spitting. And when it's done, it'll secrete an enzyme, dissolve the glue, and back itself out on its merry way. All right. Why the name deer tick is a misnomer. This tick has been documented to be associated with 125 different vertebrate hosts, okay? So this is a very complex ecosystem, a lot of moving parts. Rodents play a key role in this whole thing. They're what we call competent hosts. That means that things like mice and chipmunks and squirrels and rats and bunnies, they have the ability to harbor the Lyme disease bacteria and transmit that back into the tick population. So at this point, it's kind of like microbial ping pong. Birds play a role in a couple of different ways. We talked about one, being a dispersal agent, because ticks on their own don't move very far. They hitchhike to disperse around. But there's a number of birds that are host reservoirs for the Lyme disease bacteria. So songbirds like our American robin and our good old friend, the wild turkey, which I think we have a few of these in this county. And then we have a whole range of incompetent hosts. So things like deer, and raccoons, and coyotes, they cannot infect the tick, but they can supply dinner and help keep the population going. All right, the risk of infection, we'll show this in some data in a minute or two, is year-round, but the risk is different for the different stages of the tick. The greatest risk isn't from this adult stage tick. They're out from the fall, say late September until spring, late April into early May. And in 5 years of surveillance research, we find that on average about 50% of them are packing the bug causes Lyme disease. So far better odds than our state lottery. The biggest risk of infection is from these nymph stage ticks. They start coming out a couple weeks ago on the Cape, and they'll be active until early August or so. And we find about the infection rate is about half as much, but that's much smaller stages of tick, and that bite is more difficult to detect. We get a large stage versus small stage. So in extension, we try and figure out a way to provide people, you know, search image for, you know, how big is big, how small is small. And we may need some assistance up here. Okay. The relative size is that an adult stage tick is about the size of a sesame seed. That nymph stage tick is about the size of a poppy seed. Okay, so something the size of a poppy seed that has legs, a bad attitude, and can put you on your behind for a long time. So this slide shows actually two different things. One of the questions I get routinely from people is, Larry, when's tick season? And I say, well, it starts in January, goes to December, and then starts up again in January. Whenever you get temperatures above freezing and break in snow cover, you're going to have tick activity. But that nymph stage tick that's the size of a poppy seed out there in the summer months, that stage is responsible for 85% of all tick-borne diseases. So the summer months and that very small stage of the tick is very problematic. And not everybody's affected equally. Okay, this shows Lyme disease by age group. So on the far left here, as kids under age 5, kids age 5 to 9 have the highest incidence rate of Lyme in the state, okay? So whatever we've been doing as parents up to this point is not good enough. It is not working. We've got to rethink the whole game plan and be prepared to make an aggressive right turn in what we're doing to protect our children. Then the incidence rate goes down for people in their 20-something, 30-somethings, because people are busy, they're starting careers, they're starting families, and then you see the incidence rate start to swing back up into late 40s, 50s, and certainly into 60s and over. So we have this bimodal distribution of data. And initially, we didn't have any data to explain this, because people would say, Larry, this looks really weird. What's going on here? So until we actually got some data, I would just say, these are the soccer moms and soccer dads that are sending their children outside to play with grandma and grandpa. Okay? If you think about that explanation, it kind of hangs together, doesn't it? But as it turns out, as we get more data from UMass, these are the two groups that are actually getting the majority of the tick bites. So kids are outside all the time, they're frolicking at the edges of yards and in the woods and things like that. So a lot of exposure potential. And as you get older and have more free time, a lot of people tend to get into things like gardening and golf. And with gardening, ticks and gardening go hand in hand, okay? This is the question I get every single spring from the media. Larry, we had a brutal winter. What did that do to the tick populations? And my pat answer is absolutely nothing, okay? Because people associate, you know, a hard freeze, you don't see mosquitoes anymore. And that's true, mosquito season is done, but not so with ticks. And the other thing I tell people is that in eastern Massachusetts, in the southeast Massachusetts in particular, the winters here aren't that harsh, even in a bad year. And harsh winter is a matter of, you know, perspective. When I was with Ocean Spray Cranberries, I spent 24 years traveling to Wisconsin, where I went by the name Misha, okay? And Wisconsin has real winters. 25 below zero for extended periods of time is not unusual out there. And out in Wisconsin, deer ticks are very happy, and Wisconsin as a state is quite endemic for Lyme disease. All right, the interesting reason for this is that ticks synthesize glycerol. Well, what the heck is that? They make antifreeze, all right? So what that does is it prevents ice crystal formation in the cells, because that's what causes all the tissue damage. But they also discovered that Lyme disease bacteria feeds on the glycerol as a source of energy for itself. So this is a perfectly engineered little package. And this has taken millions of years of evolution and adaptation to come to this point. 25 years ago or so, we would have put the period on the page here with Lyme disease, okay? But this landscape has been shifting dramatically for a number of years now, and it's even shifted more even in the last two. Because what we have is a second disease, babesiosis. So this is vectored by deer ticks as well. And this is a parasite that invades your red blood cells. So it's kind of like getting malaria. And as with malaria, you get symptoms that are like, you know, cycles of fever and chills, because as this parasite is reproducing, your red blood cells are going up like little water balloons. So you get severe anemia, typically. I mean, your platelet counts will drop like a rock off a cliff. Unlike Lyme disease, this thing can be directly fatal. This is pretty serious stuff. And we also know now that you can get babesiosis from a blood transfusion, okay? So if you go to donate blood, there'll be a question there. Have you ever had babesiosis? If you check yes, you're gonna certainly get your cranberry oatmeal cookie and your cup of apple juice, and they're gonna move you on out. You're never allowed to donate blood ever again. I was reading a few weeks ago that there's a diagnostics lab that has submitted methodology to FDA for consideration on screening for babesia. So now it's in FDA's court. I didn't plan on these dramatic pauses, so I apologize. Can we have help from our IT person? I may ask you to advance the slides manually. I'll do this. Are you still there?
Yep.
Okay, we're gonna do it that way. This doesn't work. All right, where is this thing? Well, southeastern Massachusetts, southern Plymouth County, the Cape and the Islands. This thing is on the increase, and Plymouth County, the Cape and the Islands account for over 50% of the cases in the state. But as you can see, this thing is starting to show up at some levels in all 10 counties across the state. So this is following what we think was the emergence pattern of Lyme disease. Lyme disease early on started out as a Cape and Island problem and then spread continuously, where now it's a problem all across the state. That works. We have a third pathogen that causes anaplasmosis, and this is a parasite that invades one type of your white blood cells, your granulocytes. And let's look at symptoms here. Fever, nausea, the headache, the muscle pain, the abdominal pain, confusion, like the classic brain fog. A lot of these look like the symptoms of Lyme disease, and that can really throw a monkey wrench in a situation with a doctor, because they may be looking at you as, you know, maybe Lyme disease, but you're not flipping a positive test. And there's a number of doctors that won't treat you until you come up with a positive test for Lyme. And that's a big problem, because that test is extremely unreliable. You can get false negatives, you can get false positives, so it's very problematic. So if you're getting sicker and sicker and sicker, and this can really also kill you, you just might have something else completely different going on. And certainly we have our hot spots on the southeast of Massachusetts, okay? But this is more broadly distributed, Boston Metro West, up here on the North Shore. And for whatever reason, we really don't understand, Southern Berkshire County is overrun with this thing. And I've received calls from their county health nurse, and they're just screaming for help. They have no resources, which is sad. They don't know what to tell people. They don't even know how to handle it when I'm talking with the medical community. The age distribution for these two diseases quite a bit different than Lyme disease. These two diseases are rarely found in younger people, okay? But you get to be, you know, late 50s and certainly 60s and up. That's where 95% of all cases occur, okay? And when we had the lights up and as I was scanning this room, I think maybe three or four of you satisfy that demographic criteria. So you know who you are, stay safe. All right, now we've got a fourth one that we learned about a few years ago, really a Miyamotowai. And since I'm one of the two people in the state that can say Miyamotowai fluently, they're now calling this relapsing fever. Now the bug is related to the Lyme disease bacteria. It looks like this piece of fusilli-shaped pasta. Well, the bug has been known about for some time, but it was only a few years ago when they established a linkage to human disease over in Russia. And once they published their findings, they started to identify cases in the United States. In fact, the first one was on Nantucket. And so this thing, I know for a fact that it has been diagnosed and treated in Plymouth County. We've had it in Lawrenceville County for sure. And when we looked at the tick populations, we find it in about 3% of the ticks on the Cape. Okay, so it's out there at a very low level, but it's probably going to follow the pattern of these other emerging diseases. All right, the fifth one. And you probably have heard about this in the news. This has gotten a lot of attention of late. It was brought to my attention about a year and a half ago by Department of Public Health, that in the last 3 years, we've had 13 cases of Powassan virus, okay? And they know it's from people that were exposed to ticks in Massachusetts, so they weren't going someplace else, getting a tick bite and coming home. The month of onset of disease was May, June, September, October, so it tells us that both the nymphs and the adult stage deer ticks are carrying this thing. And this thing, can put you in the hospital at heart. So the typical clinical presentation is encephalitis, swelling of the brain tissue. And of those 13 cases, three were fatal. Two of those were on Cape Cod. So it's fatal in about 10% of the time. And those that survive it, because you can't treat, you can only provide supportive care, those that actually live through it end up with permanent neurological damage to some extent. So it's pretty serious stuff, and we decided to cast a net. So I have a close collaboration with the Laboratory of Medical Zoology at UMass Amherst. This is Steve Rich's group. Here's Steve. This is his research associate, Wong Zhu, who's Master Yoda of this analytical technique. And this is Emily, one of Steve's graduate students. So we talked about doing some surveillance, but we really thought we were kind of like West Nile surveillance. My friend at Cape Cod Mosquito Control, Gabby Sikorsky, she can test hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of mosquitoes before she finds a detect for West Nile virus. So we said, what the heck, we have some money, let's throw it at this and set up a plan. So last spring, we set up sampling points in Falmouth, West Barnstable, Brewster, Harwich, Orleans, and Truro. And when we got the data back, we were quite astonished at what we saw. We found Powassan-infected ticks at 4 out of 6 sites, okay, from Falmouth all the way up to Truro. And we found infection rates as high as 10%. So 1 in 10 of the ticks were carrying this thing. So it kind of confirms maybe this looks a lot like West Nile. It is a closely related virus. And this shows us that a lot of people are probably being exposed to this, but they're asymptomatic, okay, like West Nile. But in the rare instances where it goes into the nervous system, that's when it becomes very dicey. And if you look at the distribution, Falmouth all the way up to Truro, that's interesting because the animals that this virus is associated with don't have large territorial ranges, so things like skunks, possums, and raccoons. So after we reviewed these data, I shared them with a colleague of mine out in New York, Rick Ostfeld at the Cary Institute. He basically wrote the book on this ecosystem, and he's done some work on Powassan. And I asked him to look at that and tell me, hey Rick, how long do you think this has been here on Cape Cod? And he casually just tossed out a number to me, like, Larry, it could have been there for 25, probably 50,000 years. So this thing has been here for a and has just flown under the medical radar screen. I also shared these data with our Department of Public Health, and I told them, I said, I really think you should set up surveillance for this thing across the entire state, because I don't think this thing is just stopping at the Cape Cod Canal, okay? Because actually there have been some cases in some of the other counties in the state, like Essex and Middlesex and Norfolk. So the Department of Public Health, they're talking about it, which tells me kind of they're talking about it, okay? So we'll see if they actually spring into action. I think they should be. All right. We talk about our program as the three P's, three-phase plan. Protect yourself, protect your yard, and protect your pets, okay? We'll review each of those. One of the ways I look at my job is to take business away from doctors and hospitals. So in a sense, I'm in the family protection racket. So basically, let's look at an average family in Plymouth County, okay? This is obviously Norwell. We know what they're like up there, okay? And they need protection from tick-borne diseases as well as from themselves. All right, so as we talk about this, proper removal and the proper tool for removal. I get people calling me all the time about how to remove a tick. And usually it's because they have a tick attached to them. And it's interesting that when people call me about this, they automatically put me in the position of their primary caregiver. I get the most personal information you can imagine. Okay? Larry, you're not going to believe where this tick is attached. I say, oh, yeah, I will. And then they tell me. Okay? Or if they come to my office, they might start hiking up clothing because they want to show me. And I tell them, no, it's not my job description, not a doctor, never even played one on TV. Okay? The proper removal tool is really pointy tweezers, not big fat tweezers, because if you crush that tick, you just might give yourself a nasty infection, because a tick gut contains all kinds of microbes. They're like little EPA Superfund sites. You just don't know what's in there. And what you do is you just grab that tick by the head as close to your skin as you can get it, and you don't have to do an Arnold Schwarzenegger, just rip it out of your body. You just gentle upward pressure. You don't have to twist it or anything, and just gentle pressure, and that thing will pop. I tell people they should record the date, and that's important to timeline these things, because the symptoms of Lyme might show up in 3 days, might take 30 or more. So if you knew you were bitten by the tick and wrote that information down, and now you're not feeling good, now you actually have a starting point for a conversation with the doctor. I ask people if they've saved the tick. Invariably, no, although I've had a number of people tell me they tape it to index cards and put them on their fridge, like little tick mortuary. So I got that one, I got that one, I got that one before it got me. What do you think most people do with their ticks? Survey says the flush. That is the number one answer. But I've had a number of people tell me that, Larry, I just put that thing in the microwave until it blew up. There are some people who take this game very, very seriously. The reason for saving the tick is, like we do with our research ticks, you can get that tick tested at Laboratory of Medical Zoology at UMass. You merely go to tickreport.com. There's an online submission process. It's pretty easy to navigate. If you get stuck, there's a little chat button in the lower right-hand part of the screen, and they monitor that thing like a hawk, because they are very customer service focused. And once they get that tick, they're going to get the results back to you in 3 business days, guaranteed, okay? And unlike the human blood test for Lyme, this technique that we use for ticks is 99.99% accurate. It is irrefutable data. So, and what I want to do is show you a couple examples of what a tick report might look like. All right, if you go to tickreport.com and click on statistics, you can type in the zip code for your town or adjacent towns, and you'll be able to pull up all the data from any tick that was submitted from that location. And so with this, I just picked out a couple of examples that I thought were interesting. This is a three-year-old boy up in Norwell, and he had a tick attached to his head. And what they do is they identify the tick and they give you an indication of feeding status. This tick was fully engorged, meaning this tick was on this kid's head for 4, if not 5 days. I'm not sure how that happens, but the kid obviously didn't have hairdo like me, all right? And so what this suggests is that there was plenty of time for transmission of any of these pathogens. For most of the pathogens we deal with, we have a 24-hour rule of thumb. If it was on you for less than 24 hours, the risk of transmission is considered to be very low. Maybe not zero, but very low. And after 24 hours, and certainly after 48 hours, the risk of transmission ramps up quickly. So this kid showed he was positive for Borrelia burgdorferi that causes Lyme disease. So without medical intervention, I'm confident this kid would have came down with Lyme disease, okay? But he was also infected with Babesia, and this is pretty interesting. So we have this co-infection, which we're seeing more and more of. And so while Babesiosis is pretty uncommon in younger people, it does mean it doesn't occur. So it presents a problem to the doctor if the kid's not feeling good. What would the combination of these two pathogens look like as a clinical presentation? It kind of compounds the problem. So here's the value of the test. Is it now a patient has hard data that they can present to their doctor? So if you get a tick bite, you get tested, now you're not feeling good, and you're starting to think about, am I going to be treated? But you can say, hey, I was potentially exposed to this. Because this doesn't mean you are guaranteed exposure, although being fully engorged pretty much ensures that did happen. But you can say I was exposed to this, potentially exposed to this, and maybe even this, because these ticks can carry, you know, 3, 4, you know, even 5 pathogens. So this is actually now being considered by the medical community a useful diagnostic tool because it helps them home in on what are the symptoms that they should be looking on. Now, in terms of transmission rate, one of the things I want to mention, while these pathogens have a 24-hour rule of thumb, the difference with Powassan virus is the transmission rate is 15 minutes, okay? So shortly after the time of attachment. I received a call from a woman about 8 weeks ago, and she told me that she pulled a fully engorged tick off her husband, and she had to tell me where she pulled it off of, okay? And they decided to send it out for testing, and they went to see the doctor, and the doctor just gave them a couple of doses of doxy, which is fairly standard practice. And then the doctor said he wasn't going to do another thing until he saw a copy of the tick report. So that is very good news. Now the medical community realizes that contrary to what the CDC says, which is tick testing is useless, they're maintaining that it doesn't mean you're going to get sick. Well, duh, we all know that, but it does show potential exposure. All right, here's a 63-year-old woman in Eastham, and she hit the lottery. She was positive for every single thing we were looking for. And this tick was partially fed, okay? So we don't follow the patient history, okay? We can follow it up to this point, so we don't know what happened later on. But this certainly suggests that there was potential for a few really bad days, okay? All right, I talk a lot about repellents with people as a first line of defense, and repellents come in a number of different flavors, okay? So you have the products like D or D alternatives like picaridin or oil of flame eucalyptus. And these are products for treating exposed skin. So what that means is that tick is not going to bite you where the repellent is, but that tick just might keep marching along until it finds a place on your body where there's no repellent, okay, and dig in. And then we have this group, the all naturals that came on the scene. And these things really resonate with some people, particularly parents, because they think they're using a product that's safe and effective, the best of both worlds. and nothing could be further from the truth. Here's the big reason. Here's the big difference between these two groups. These up here on top, these are EPA registered. So that means if the product says it repels ticks and mosquitoes for 6 hours, there are data on file in EPA to support that claim. These things here, they're exempt from registration, okay? There's a loophole that they've jumped through, and that means they don't have to provide a data point at all to prove they do anything. So when I'm having conversations with parents in particular, and they're telling me about, you know, their use and why they're happy with these products because their kid hasn't been sick since they've been using them, my answer to that is that you're dodging bullets with your children's lives, flat out. I wish the Federal Trade Commission would swoop in and take these things off the shelf. They've been beating down on the fraudulent products for things like bed bugs, and they're starting to do the same for mosquitoes. In fact, I read something recently where there was a company that sold a mosquito bracelet, and it gave you a halo effect of protection all over, all right? And so the FTC said, we want you to remove that part off the shelf. And just to make our point very clear, we're dropping a $350,000 fine on you, okay? So hopefully eventually they'll catch up with this group of people. Because it's very misleading, it's leading people into a false sense of security. All right, here's another repellent that I've spent a lot of time talking about with people that contains the active ingredient Permethrin. And so this is for treating fabrics. So pants, these are, you know, out of my sock drawer, just treated. And it'll keep its activity through 6 washings. Permethrin is not that water soluble. And treating footwear. So this lasts for 6 washings or 45 days, whichever comes first. And I treat my footwear about every 3 or 4 weeks. And treating footwear, that's mission critical. Okay? Yes, okay. And the reason for this is pretty important. Those nymph stage ticks that are the size of a poppy seed that are responsible for 85% of all tick-borne illnesses, they are down in the leaf litter. So your footwear is the first place they attach to. And this isn't just a repellent. What I found when I was doing my initial early research on this product about 5 years ago, I found if you put a tick on a Permethrin-treated fabric surface for 60 seconds, and then transfer it to a clean surface, on average that tick is dead in 9 minutes. It is a real attitude adjuster. This is the most effective tool in the box. I wear this, I treat my clothing and wear it year round. I'm basically trusting my life with this product. And since I started doing this, I've not got a single tick bite in the 5 years I've been doing this, okay? So hands down, this is the way to go. There's a number of different formulations. A number of aerosol products are on the market, and Sawyer has this water-based pump spray. I actually prefer this because I think it gives a better spray pattern. These aerosols might spray a nice mist for a little while and then start, you know, foaming out, and so a lot of times they run out of propellant before they run out of product. So basically for treating, you just spray the clothes till they're visibly damp. Let them dry. You don't do it while you're wearing them. Put your pants and stuff over a porch rail and put your shoes on the deck. And when I'm treating my pants, when they're dry, I turn them inside out. I treat from about the mid-thigh down in case ticks come from underneath. So in my business, sometimes you have to think like a tick, all right? All right, you can also buy pre-treated clothing from a company, Insect Shield primarily. There's another new player on the block now. And their clothing, it lasts through 70 washings, basically the life of the garment. And you can buy insect repellent clothing from places like Orbis and L.L. Bean, but Insect Shield's in the private label business. So if you bought it from Orbis, it came from Insect Shield. And the third way you can skin this cat is you can send your clothing to Insect Shield. They will treat them, send them back to you with the same 70 washings claim. And for another $3, they'll embroider Insect Shield the waistband and you can make your own very old fashioned statement, okay? All right, This is my elephant in the room slide, okay? Because when I'm at workshops and have parents there, they're looking at me like I'm absolutely insane, okay? They're saying, Larry, you're telling me to put my children in clothing treated with a synthetic chemical pesticide. And I nod my head, yes, I draw a line in the sand, I'm not budging, because what I do is I reference back to kids age 5 to 9. Remember them? Highest incidence rate of Lyme in the state. We need to consider doing something very different here. So I spend as much time as necessary to walk people through the toxicology profile of permethrin. All right? But the basic tenet of toxicology is not the molecules, the dose that makes the poison and how it was introduced into your body. So for permethrin, it's over 2,000 times more toxic to a tick than a person. People are big, ticks a little, doesn't take much to knock them off. EPA did establish a position on this. Reasonable certainty that permethrin treated clothing poses no harm to infants, children, pregnant women, or nursing mothers. And their criteria certainly would be conservative. And the reason for this is absolutely key. This is because permethrin and other synthetic pyrethroids like resmethrin and bifenthrin and the whole lot, they have a really low dermal absorption. And whatever is absorbed is metabolized very quickly. They demonstrated this with human test subjects. They would topically apply permethrin, and the breakdown products of permethrin showed up in their urine a couple hours later. National Academy of Sciences, that is not a lightweight group at all. They were wondering about long-term exposure, okay? So they made exposure assumptions that people were wearing permethrin treated everything 18 hours a day, every single day for 10 years. And when they rolled up that aggregate exposure, they saw no reason to expect an adverse effect. And finally, one more. And finally, the last thing I point out is that permethrin is the active ingredient that you would literally slather on an infant for treating scabies mite at a much higher concentration, 5% versus 0.5 on your clothing, as the standard active ingredient to treat head lice, which is making a comeback in our school systems. So one of the things I message is that when I look and think about what I'm pretty sure is a very low risk cup for exposure to permethrin, and I weigh that against the consequences of one of the tick-borne diseases, for me that is the easiest math to do in the world, by far. All right, phase two, protect your yard, okay? There's a lot that's been written about wildlife and habitat management in terms of modifying your environment and reduce exposure to ticks. One of the things you see commonly recommended, put up ear fencing. Well, there was some really good research done at Penn State University on this. They fenced off different size areas in the woods, and they looked at the number of ticks inside the enclosure versus outside the enclosure. And they found out that until you fenced off at least about 15 acres, that's when you started to see fewer ticks inside than outside. And I don't know about you, but I think 15 acres is just larger than the average house lot size in Plymouth County, okay? Move your bird feeders. Well, move them where? I mean, if I love my bird feeders. If I move them and then I see my neighbor's bird feeders 10 feet off the edge of my driveway, I started to wonder about, you know, what we're talking about here. I saw one extension program, I think it was Oklahoma, and they said move your bird feeders 70 feet, precisely 70 feet. And I was thinking, that's really cool. What happens if you move them 65? Do you have, you know, tick apocalypse or what? Prune trees and let more sunlight into, you know, the floor where the leaf litter and stuff is. A lot of work. Move wood piles. This person is obviously more afraid about snakes than ticks. When I looked into these various things, what I found is that there's not a shred of data to support doing any of those things. And we have a program that's built on the foundation of evidence-based science. So if I can't find data to support a recommendation, I'm not telling people to waste their time or money doing it. All right, your yard. I'm a fan of perimeter yard sprays, okay, the 1-2 punch. First, clothing, and maybe consider a yard treatment. further reduce your risk exposure. Deer ticks, you're not going to find them out in an open lawn. Short grass, direct sunlight, lower humidity, that is a hostile environment for ticks. But you get into a transition zone. So where the edge of the lawn might be in partial shade, then you get brush and trees and leaf litter, cooler and higher humidity, that's where you're going to find the ticks. But if you think about those environmental conditions, okay, carefully, what are your ornamental plantings at the edge of your house or the edge of your sidewalk? They provide shade, some amount of leaf litter, and higher humidity. You can easily find ticks there. There's some interesting work that was done in Connecticut, surveillance work. They get people all over the state, you know, mailing ticks for identification and then for testing. And one of the things on the questionnaire is, what activity were you engaged in when you got your tick bite? And over two-thirds of the people reported they were in their own backyard, you know, kids playing or people gardening. So you don't have to go up to, you know, Iowa Standard State Forest to get a tick bite. A lot of people get them from their own backyard. In fact, ticks and gardening do go hand in hand. So for the yard spray, I recommend a spray late May and late June. That'll cover that nymph stage window of activity. And then again in mid-October when the next generation of adult stage ticks are out. So a three-spray program. You can hire a service to do this. Most commercial companies would use a product called Telstar, which is bifenthrin, and very, very effective. There are also some companies that sell, you know, an all-natural solution. Usually contains 10% rosemary and a few other essential oils. And the research that was done by Tom Mather at URI, he showed that these products have very, very low knockdown on contact. And once that spray is dry, it has zero residual activity. You lay down something like bifenthrin or permethrin, you get 2 to 3 weeks of activity down in that leaf litter layer. So it's a good strategy. So you can either hire somebody, or if you want to save yourself some money, you can go to a garden center, get a hose and a sprayer. Bonide has a product line, including one called EIGHT. So you just hook it up to your garden hose and point and shoot, lick it, dilute it to the right concentration, and you're good to go. Now, one of the questions I think I would anticipate here is I get it all the time. Larry, what about our honeybees? They need our help. And I believe that a yard treatment is completely compatible with bee production, because I personally don't see bees foraging in leaf litter, okay? So, and if you want to ensure, you know, lack of contact, do it in the early evening when they're all back in the hive. Here's a product that's on the market that you may be familiar with called Gaminex Tick Tubes, okay? And this is an interesting product. It's a cardboard tube that has cotton balls treated with permethrin. The idea is that the mice will steal the cotton balls, carry them down to the nest, and line their bed and basically self-treat. So it's an interesting product concept. But does it work? And there were two really good studies done on this. Okay, one by Kirby Stafford in Connecticut, and the other by Tom Daniels at Fordham University in New York. And they each found that these tick tubes had no material impact on tick populations whatsoever. And they came up with identical reasons to explain their data. They said, not all mice are compelled to steal cotton balls just because of the air. And not all tick-carrying animals steal cotton balls. Chipmunks don't, meadow voles don't, shrews don't, raccoons don't, possums don't, birds don't. So unless your yard is totally inhabited by white-footed mice that have an obsession for cotton balls, there's no reason to expect this product to work. Needless to say, the manufacturer, Eagle Health, has taken me off their holiday greeting card list. It was really hurtful. It's taken me a long time to get over that. Not. And protect your pets, okay? Certainly, if you have animals that go outside, it's worth doing a look-see or a tick check. There's a number of over-the-counter products that are available, some of which you can use on both dogs and cats, and some of which you can't use on cats, but you can use on dogs. My wife happens to work at Petco up in the Avon area, and she has told me that Canine Advantix 2 for dogs is just blowing Frontline off the shelf because it's that much more effective. And you don't want to put Canine Advantix 2 on a cat. Cats are very sensitive to vermifugin. You can hurt it badly with exposure. But those topicals, you know, monthly topicals, for some people it gets kind of old. Did I remember to apply it this month, or do I feel like applying it today? And so to address that, Bayer Ag came up with their own solution to this a few years ago as the Seresto collar. You put that on your animal, you get 6 to actually 8 months of continuous flea and tick control, okay? I've talked with a number of people that swapped out from Advantix 2 to the collar, and they're very, very happy. Now, one of the things you should be aware of is the upfront cost of this might be $65 or $70. But when you do the arithmetic and compare it to the cost of these monthly topicals, this is far more cost effective in the long run, okay? And Insect Shield, they are not gonna miss the marketing opportunity. So they came out with a line of clothing for your pooches that's treated with permethrin. I happen to know the company president now of Insect Shield. And when I saw this product launch, I contacted him and I said, you know, hey, Jason, you had a little too much free time on your hands down there in North Carolina. All right. So what we've essentially done in 6 years is we've simplified the game plan, okay? You look at a lot of traditional extension programs, they might give you a list of 8 to 10 things to do. And people are just so busy today. We have things coming at us from 100 different directions. If I gave you a list of 8 to 10 things and you left this room, you're likely not to implement any of them. But if I gave you 3 things to think about that you could implement today, so tick checks and use of permethrin-treated clothing, you do that alone, you've reduced your chances of getting a tick bite by 80 to 90%. Okay, you toss in a perimeter yard spray because I think you have to look at this like hand-to-hand combat. You don't want to lose a single fight. And pet protection, 1, 2, 3. So while these tick-borne illnesses can be life-threatening or at the very least life-altering, the silver lining is that they're entirely preventable. And with that, His Holiness and I will entertain any questions that you may have. Can we have the lights up? There you are. You're still here. That's good. Yes, sir.
I've been told that you can basically designate ticks by putting some clothing into the dryer.
Sure, that's our standard recommendation. Is when you come in. Did you hear the question? Okay, his question was, what's the impact of putting clothes in the dryer? Will that kill ticks? And the answer is absolutely yes. We routinely tell people when you come in from an outdoor activity, put your clothes in the dryer for 20 minutes. So you up the temperature, drop humidity, ticks aren't that tough. There's a high school student in Brookline, and she saw recommendations about putting in the washer and then the dryer on high heat for an hour, and she was concerned she was gonna ruin her clothes. So she did her own research, okay? So she collected ticks and put them in the dryer for different lengths of time, and she found it took as little as 5 minutes to kill a tick, okay? There's also research that demonstrates that ticks can go through a wash cycle, okay? The only thing that happens to them when they come out is they're nice and shiny. Yes, ma'am.
The preponderance of cases of infection
that's a very good observation that you made. Why do they have the incidence rates they have? Well, I can tell you one of the reasons is they're doing everything wrong, protecting themselves. One of their favorite products they use are those Gamma-X tick tubes. They're so focused on killing Bambi that they're losing sight of solving the problem. But we had a research project on the Cape and the Islands for 5 years, so we did a lot of sampling over there. And what I think is happening, and what you pointed out, they're islands, but they're not big, and they're offshore quite a ways. And I think what is happening is that they have a higher ambient humidity for longer periods of time. And with that, the ticks can be out there questing for longer periods of time. It sets up more opportunities for exposure. A place like here, when it gets hot, the ticks actually, because they can't control or regulate their water balance, they go deeper and deeper and deeper into the leaf litter. And we see the same thing on Cape Cod, because I've been thinking a lot about this, that the highest incidence rates we have on the Cape are Wellfleet and Truro and East Ham and Chatham, which those are just very narrow spits of land with ocean on both sides. And when I look at the incidence rate of Lyme in Plymouth County, what pops out at you is Marion, Rochester, so all those towns right along the coast. So it's, yeah, I think it's a microclimate effect. Yes, ma'am. That was us. We had a 5-year study on the 4-poster deer feeding station system, okay? And as you indicated, these are big hoppers with troughs on the inside that you load up with whole kernel corn. And so what's also present is two paint rollers on either side. So when the deer kind of go to get at the corn, it kind of brushes their neck and chin. And the idea is to kill the ticks before they have a chance to lay eggs. Well, we ran 42 of these things on the Cape and the Islands, and we reduced the tick population by a whopping 7%. And so it's expensive. And when we were kind of looking at the maintenance information, like there were certain stations we were loading up with tons of corn and others not so much, and we were assuming it was deer that was taking away the corn. So I put out trail cameras and moved them around for a year and a half, and I accumulated 450,000 frames of imagery that I went through each and every one, okay? And on the Cape, what I found out is that we didn't feed a single deer. I fed 30,000 pounds of whole kernel corn to raccoons, okay? And you would see raccoons sitting on these things. They'd be laying on their backs against paint rollers that are lathered up with Prometheus, and they'd have a pile of corn on their bellies like they were watching their favorite movie. It was incredible. So we're looking at, I mean, we thought, okay, let's look at that as an area-wide management tactic to bring the overall populations down. But these things, they're expensive. They cost about $600 a piece, and gray squirrels will just, they don't go to the trough, they just chew through the side of the hopper. And the manufacturer wouldn't teach us how to, you know, spot weld the supplies, materials, and fix them. It was easier to sell us new ones.
Any natural predation? I hope you follow well ticks, but all of us that can't have a flock of guinea fowl, are there any other?
Well, the guinea fowl, Christy Brinkley and Martha Stewart were doing that a few years ago, got a lot of headlines. In fact, that year it was all the rage in the Hamptons, okay? And my friend Rick Osfeld, he tossed a student at that question, because that's what grad students are for, you're an indentured servant. And what she found was that the guinea hens and other birds, they could find adult stage ticks But they couldn't find the nymph stage ticks to save their lives, okay? So the guinea fowl, you know, the only benefit they have is that nobody's gonna sneak up on you. They are allowed. In terms of other predators, snakes and lizards, ground-dwelling birds will eat them. There's a parasitic fungus that when the spore touches the tick's ectoskeleton, it'll germinate and penetrate inside the tick and start eating it from the inside out, kind of like invasion of the body snatchers. So everything is part of the food chain, all right? So that fungus has actually been commercialized as a consideration for pruning the yard sprays. Way in back. Yes.
If I spray my clothing and then come inside and my cat gets on me, is that going to be dangerous?
No. Once it's dry on the surface, there will be very little exposure. In fact, if you use a topic like canine Vanix 2 and you have a cat and a dog in the same house, the vets will tell you when you treat the dog, keep it separate from the cat until it dries on the neck of the dog. Yes.
Once a tick has landed on your clothing, how long typically is it before it attaches to you, starts, you know, bites you?
It's got to find a spot that it's happy with. So it's usually where clothing is restrictive. So behind your knees, your pelvic area, your armpits, your neckline. Other than Lone Star tick, deer ticks don't run, but they don't stop walking either. They'll just keep marching along. So it doesn't take them a long time to find out where they're going to die tonight.
And how effective is then showering before they detach? Is that?
You see that recommendation all the time. And again, there's no data to suggest that ticks get washed off. I mean, those little claws are pretty sharp. I think the recommendation for the shower is that requires you to kind of absolutely drop everything. And so that's an opportunity for a tick check.
Thank you.
Was there another?
Over here.
Over where? Oh, okay.
Are there weather conditions that affect the population at all?
That's an interesting question because things like that. Last year we had a severe drought, and so there were predictions that the tick populations took it on the chin. Okay, so whenever you get events like that that are unique, the number of experts that go into the newspaper with quotes is amazing. When it became moister in the fall, the tick populations were fine. What I told people, because the Cape Cod Times, when they read about that in another newspaper, they want to run the same story. So they call me to get a soundbite out of me to get the storybook. And those type of stories, I don't take the bait on. So I said, you know, it's not going to happen when it gets very dry. They just go deeper and deeper into the leaf litter. These ticks have been on the planet for about 140 million years, okay? There's all these horseshoe crabs. So they've seen it all. They know how to adapt to any conditions to survive. Yes, sir?
Is it possible to give us a short synopsis on the biology, like from timeline of egg, larvae?
Yeah, what I can do is take this deck, convert it to a PDF, and your association can have it as a reference on your website. And I'll throw in some bonus slides, like the tick life cycle. The tick life cycle is actually 2 years long. So the ticks have four life stages, an egg stage, a larval stage, a nymph stage, and an adult stage. So at three of the stages they feed, but then ticks spend a lot of downtime. No, I can't, actually. Since I don't have a qualified medical opinion, Barnstable County doesn't want Larry practicing medicine without a license. All I can say is that the bullseye doesn't appear in about 40% of the cases, And I can say it's not always a bullseye. And it doesn't always appear where the tick bit, it might, you know, if you get a tick bite on your arm, it might show up on your thigh. But it also can be an irregular blotch as well. But that's about as far as I can go. Way up there.
Yep.
Well, how do you suggest you sterilize tweezers after removing the tick?
Can you say that a little louder?
How do you suggest sterilizing tweezers after you remove the tick?
If just rubbing alcohol or vodka, whatever you have handy. Adult stage tick, on average 50% of them carry the bug that attacks Lyme. In terms of co-infection, in our 5 years of surveillance, we found that 8% of the ticks were co-infected with at least two pathogens, in some cases three, in some cases all four. So the odds are pretty good that you're potentially exposed to something with any tick bite. Yes, ma'am. It's a hose end sprayer, and it's 098 BIGHT.
Have you heard of people ever having chronic Lyme's?
On what Lyme's?
Chronic. Well, they've had a few years.
Oh, chronic? That is a major medical controversy. I can speak to that a little in that you have a group of doctors over here that say chronic Lyme does not exist. You get your 28 days of antibiotics, you're cured. What happens afterward is a post-Lyme injury of some sort. And then you've got a group of doctors over here that they have data to show that you indeed can get a systemic infection because this bacteria can travel to different body tissues and become hard for antibiotics to get at. And so you're either here or here. Unfortunately, there's nobody in the middle, which is unfortunate. And these two groups, they just don't disagree. They're adversarial against each other. So the patient's paying the price, unfortunately. But the good news is that the group over here, there was a big battle they won last year legislatively. A bill was introduced up on Beacon Hill that would require insurance companies to cover treatment of antibiotics beyond 28 days. And as you can guess, there was a lot of battling behind the scenes to prevent that. So at the first term, Governor Baker vetoed it, okay? But the people in the chronic Lyme community, which they are a community, believe me, you kick one and they all respond. So they get on the horns to their state reps and they overturn Governor Baker's veto, and that is now law. So if you're working with a doctor and they think maybe you need 3 months, maybe you need 6 months, maybe you need even 9 months, now insurance companies have to cover the cost of that. Anybody else? Well, Chuck, I think this has been a pretty good event.